spirit in this place.
Thank you, that wonderful choir of First Presbyterian Church in Brooklyn. I'm Janet Dewart Bell. Welcome to this evening, Evolving Faith in a Secular World. This concert idea grew out of an idea from the late Professor Derrick Bell, my beloved husband, because he thought students really needed a break. And that even though it's about faith, it's a universal faith. Derrick wrote from his deep Christian background, so you'll hear a lot of Christian references, but that is only because he felt that to be authentic, he had to come from his own real authentic place and his experience. But those of you, those of us who had the privilege of knowing him, knew how he embraced everyone without question. So it's in that spirit that we have this event. I want to thank very much New York University School of Law, particularly the Office of Student Affairs, David Mora, who is doing so many things for this event, and without whom this event would not have happened. We had to cancel because of some one of those freak snowstorms that we had. And David really moved heaven and earth, which means that very complicated NYU school schedule, to reschedule this concert. So special thanks to him and to our co-sponsors from BALSA. Tonight we have two of the readers, which is a great idea that actually David had, to have student readers. So I'm going to introduce them right now, even though they're going to come up later and read. So I'm going to introduce my colleagues here tonight. We have Professor Kendall Davis from Columbia. Kendall Thomas, I know him like he's my brother, from Columbia Law School, and who was also the Derrick Bell Lecturer in year 2004, and just a wonderful close friend. And we have from BALSA, Donald Cooley, who's the outgoing chair. And let me make sure I get this right, Ivan Elosiebo, the outgoing vice chair. So that's pretty exciting. So you'll hear from them again in just a couple minutes. So thank you very, very much. So with that, Kendall Thomas will start reading.
We gather this evening in a time of deep crisis. It is a time when we are burdened with old worries and increased concerns about the country and the world. There is personal uncertainty as you prepare for a profession in the law. For those in the first year, awaiting or reviewing fall semester grades, there is understandable uncertainty, not about your skills or society's need for those skills, but about whether you can earn a living practicing those much-needed skills. This evening's program seeks to ease your fears and lift your spirits through music, much of it created hundreds of years ago. The creators did so while held in brutal slavery, and yet some among them, by interweaving melody and lyric in songs of faith, were able to transcend the awful oppression that defined their lives. Embracing faith that was undergirded by this music helped slaves to be spiritually nourished, even while physically bound. The music encompassed all of this despair and somehow empowered the singers with a transformative faith.
Emancipation Proclamation proclaimed an end to slavery, but it did not bring freedom. The lives of Black people continued to be burdened with the hostility that replaced chains with intimidation, murder, and exploitation. And yet they persevered. Later, after Black people began migrating to the North, those we now call gospel singers updated the music of Black religion. Many of them spirituals, of course, but also standard hymns and newly written songs. Rooted deep in Black culture, blessed with talent, honed in belief, these singers and their music comforted the afflicted, consoled the bereaved, strengthened the weak, reassured the discouraged, and reminded all those who heard them of the message in 2 Corinthians 4:8-9. We are all afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed.
From an early time, gospel music communicated a political as well as religious dimension. While praising Jesus, the lyrics contained directions for those planning escapes from slavery. A century later, black and white civil rights protesters found strength in songs written by slaves and transformed them into freedom songs.
I woke up this morning with my mind set on freedom. Woke up this morning with my mind set on freedom. Woke up this morning with my mind set on freedom. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Slavery and its century-long aftermath could not be endured by songs alone, no matter how inspiring. Survival required that hatred had to be sublimated and transformed in a commitment to stand, and when knocked down by racial hostility, to rise and stand again.
We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, but we get up. Oh my, for a saint is just a sinner who fell down, but he didn't stay there and got up. Come on.
We fall down sometimes, but we get up.
Get back up again.
We fall down,
yeah.
We fall down, but we get up.
up again.
We fall down.
No time to worry.
But
we get back up again.
We fall down.
Sometimes we
but
fall.
We get
but
up.
We get back up again.
Law school is certainly not slavery or segregation with its total physical domination of a people. But legal education can exact a more subtle, though still effective, subordination of self. Modern society imposes quite effective facsimiles in the form of competitiveness to get into school, pressures to perform well, and anxiety to get a good job. The price of learning to think like a lawyer is quite high. Beyond the ethical dilemmas, legal education, particularly in the first year, poses serious challenges to the learning processes and performance qualities that got us here. The workload is heavy, but we are used to hard work. Classes, though, are large, the opportunity for participation minimal. The feedback varies from just adequate to non-existent. And while there may be a midterm, much of the grade depends on a sudden, death final exam. I'm about to administer one of those in a few days, so it threw me. A sudden death final exam, presented in a strange form that departs radically from what you were expected to do in the classroom. What you learned about doctrine was important, but not sufficient for a really good grade. Those who do well in this exam process have worked hard, certainly, but they also bring to the exam room, and their grades reflect, skills of organization, memory, and effective writing that were not taught as part of the course. Is it any surprise that as the weeks go by, Gospel music offers a form of spiritual comfort food, somewhat like mac and cheese. For most law students is not failing. Very few admit it to this law school flunk out, but some do not do well, a self-defined failure. By the second year, grades, be they at the top or only average, become less important because conditions in the world provide law students with many opportunities to protest against the injustices of war, the denial of rights based on race, gender, and sexual orientation. Taking part in these efforts, you continue a long tradition set by those in this country who were for so long systematically denied rights and justice. Often, they turn to religion and the music of that religion for solace, for strength, for an almost miraculous joy. It is this joy in the center of a storm of hostility that moved a modern gospel singer and composer, Richard Smallwood, to write a song that is a formula for survival in this land, so often alien, so little like home.
I've lost my direction. You're the compass for my way. You're the fire and light when the nights are long and cold. Oh, in sadness, you are the laughter that shatters all my fears. Oh, when I'm all alone, your hand is there to hold. Oh, Jesus,
you're the center. You're the center.
In the meadows and the streets, the voices of the children, my family and my home. Oh, you're the source and the finisher of my history.
For many law students, the disenfranchisement of the first months can be eased by music like that you are hearing this evening. This is true, though not everyone here accepts without question the traditional doctrines of the Christian church that mark the lyrics of this music. For some, religion has become lost in a wilderness of doctrine and strong condemnation around so-called amoral issues, mostly connected with sexual behavior. There is confusion because the condemnations are so contrary to teachings of love and forgiveness. As a result, many students have fallen away from church-connected faith. Increasingly, they have difficulty imagining God as a supernatural being who controls all that happens in the world, punishing evil and rewarding good. As one student put it, "I want to believe, but I can't fake it," treating religious belief like fire insurance. There are, of course, many spiritual paths that are not centered on religion of any kind. Many ethical people want nothing to do with organized religion, but they view life as a gift with an obligation to uplift the lives of those around them.
Today, most theologians and religious scholars, while rejecting the concept of a theistic God, a supernatural being who determines all earthly events, do believe in God as an important concept, one beyond human ability to define. Episcopalian Bishop John Shelby Spong sums up the theological view of God by urging that we recognize that we cannot define God. We can only experience the sense of transcendence, wonder, and awe. When we talk about God, we are not talking about an external being. We are talking about a human perception, and as such, God is ever-changing. Bishop Spong further explains, when we talk about Jesus, we are not talking about an external savior who came to rescue us, but a life in whom and through whom we can find transcendence. Jesus empowers us to be more deeply and fully human and to enter higher and higher levels of consciousness where we finally discover that we live in God and God lives in us. These views do not negate the inspirational messages of Jesus' life, calling for inclusion and rejecting exclusion. The well-known parable of the Good Samaritan was aimed at the Jews of that time, to whom a Samaritan was not some faceless, interchangeable placeholder, but quite the contrary, a hated enemy, a half-breed, and a perverter of true religion. A Samaritan, far from a good neighbor, was a socio-religious outcast. Given the historical significance of the Samaritan, we can comprehend the real impact of this parable, both then and now. It was the preaching of inclusiveness that got Jesus nailed to the cross. Many modern Christian churches tend to forgo the revolutionary essence of Jesus' message, preaching instead that Jesus died for our sins, and thus we must honor his sacrifice by our commitment to him through church dogma and ritual.
By giving priority to the rituals of worship, we neglect what Reverend Peter Gomes calls the sublime logic of his teaching and the undaunted example of his life. Of course, we should not be so contemptuous of those who take Christian texts literally that we fail to take them seriously. This was the great theologian Reinhold Niebuhr's view, one that is shared by a great many biblical scholars. They do not deny that a literal belief in the biblical stories was important in the development of the early church, and even today, many find not literal truth, but spiritual meaning in the many elements of the Christian narrative, including the reports of Jesus healing the sick and raising the dead. The value of these messages is less their truth than their illustrations of their revolutionary character. It is this essential element that is not emphasized in many Christian congregations. A former student of Professor Bell, who later went to a divinity school, provides one explanation. He writes, "Most of my colleagues, that is, future pastors here, are afraid of preaching and teaching what they learn at seminary, in part due to the perceived negative reactions from the conservative believers. So there's a particularly big education gap for religion between academia and the laity. This seems unbelievable. How can ministers who learn one thing in divinity school then go out and preach in ways that deny the enlightenment of a century or more of research and revelation?"
Still, many Americans hold tightly to views likely formed in Sunday school and don't want those views challenged. It leads to what writer Jim McKibben calls the Christian paradox. His survey of American religion led him to conclude that America is simultaneously the most professedly Christian of the developed nations and the least Christian in its knowledge and behavior. He found that only 40% of Americans can name more than four of the Ten Commandments, and a scant half can cite any of the four authors of the Gospels. 12%, when asked, guessed that Joan of Arc was Noah's wife. McKibben also discovered that 3/4 of Americans believe the Bible teaches that God helps those who help themselves. That is, 3 out of 4 Americans believe that this uber-American idea, a notion at the core of our current individualistic politics and culture, appears in Scripture, when in fact it was uttered by Ben Franklin. And the laity are not alone in their willingness to accept the creed, but not its obligations. Remember, Those who opposed the racial and economic justice efforts of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. were Christian ministers. In his 1963 letter from a Birmingham jail, one of the great theological papers of the 20th century, King reflected on the Christian racism contradiction when he responded to church leaders who publicly criticized his leadership of the marches that led to violent reactions by the police and local officials. "There was a time," said King, "when the church was not very powerful, and the time when the early Christians rejoiced at being deemed worthy to suffer for what they believed." Utilizing his inimitable way with language, King wrote, "In those days, the church was not merely a thermometer that recorded the ideas and principles of popular opinion. It was a thermostat that transformed the mores of society. Whenever the early Christians entered a town, the people in power became disturbed and immediately sought to convict the Christians for being disturbers of the peace and outside agitators. But the Christians pressed on in the conviction that they were a colony of heaven, called to obey God rather than man."
In his letter, King wondered when all this changed, when this all changed. When did the church succumb to intimidate rather than illuminate a congregation with descriptions of God's power? Whatever the causes, King said, too often the Christian church has kept Christ in its name, but not in its heart. Birmingham's church leaders were not the first who chose social stability over the basic precept of their religion. The slave singers we celebrate resisted and kept the faith. Thank you. That was for Derrick. The novelist Nikos Kazantzakis dramatizes our human need and failing in his novel, The Last Temptation of Christ. In a scene following the Last Supper, Jesus tells his disciples that he must die as foretold by the prophets. They weep and wail, urging him not to leave or to take them with him. One of them, though, Jacob, quickly reconciles himself to Jesus' death and promises that the disciples will ensure that his words shall not perish. We'll establish them firmly in new holy scriptures. We'll make laws, build our own synagogues, and select our own high priests, scribes, and Pharisees. Jesus is horrified. "You crucify the Spirit," Jacob, he shouted. "No, no, I don't want that." Jacob tries to reassure him. "This is the only way we can prevent the Spirit from turning into air and escaping. But it won't be free anymore. It won't be Spirit." "That doesn't matter," Jacob responds. "It will look like Spirit. For our work, Rabbi, that's sufficient." Encompasses the law as well as religion. What course can the lawyer follow who seeks success and also wants to maintain personal integrity in a nation that claims to be religious and yet functions in a political and social society of God helping those who help themselves? In religion as law, there are rules to be followed, adherence to which becomes something of a ritual. As Patrick J. Schiltz, now a federal judge, points out in his oft-cited article in the Vanderbilt Law Review, law teachers, the organized bar, and other lawyers want you to consider ethics in terms of the model rules of professional responsibility. These are good rules that should be followed. But Schultz warns that the formal rules represent nothing more than the lowest common denominator of conduct that a highly self-interested group will tolerate. He warns that the sleaziest lawyers will be scrupulous in their compliance with the formal rules, a necessary but never sufficient part of being an ethical lawyer. For this, you must act ethically even when you are not required to do so by any rule. Practice law, he advises, consistent with your intuitions of what is honest and fair. Treat others as you want them to treat you. Show respect and compassion. Keep your promises. Judge Schlitz suggests, and I agree, that what makes the challenge of ethical living particularly tough is that our society values success over humane behavior, whether that is measured by religious or secular standards of integrity. Getting to be number one tends to be more important than how you got there. What can we do as individuals? As Jesus reassured Peter, save yourself, the rest are mine.
Actually, Judge Schultz's secular urging that we look to ourselves for ethical guidance rather than rules has deep historical roots. Elaine Pagels, in her book, The Gnostic Gospels, introduces us to an early Christian sect who accepted Jesus' teachings but interpreted them differently. The essence of the Gnostic teachings was that the presence of the divine is within each human and that the road to salvation is through deep self-knowledge. An example of the self-discovery that appears key in many of the writings is found in the Gospel of Thomas, perhaps the most cited of the Gnostic Gospels. Thomas reports, his disciple questioned him and said to him, do you want us to fast? How shall we pray? Shall we give alms? What diet shall we observe? In effect, they were seeking rules, the obedience of which would ensure their salvation. Jesus replied, do not tell lies, and do not do what you hate. Elaine Pagels points out that his ironic answer turns the disciples' questions back to them. They cannot absolve themselves by simple adherence to rules. The advice is revelatory regarding life and about Jesus that emerges from the myths, the dogma, the institutionalization of religion. It gives meaning to much of his teachings. It is also universal.
Both day and night, please order my steps in your word. Order my steps in your word.
Won't you please order my steps?
Wash my heart, Jesus. Teach me to love your word, Jesus. Order my steps in your word.
Message, do not tell lies, and do not do what you hate, refutes the widespread belief that living a life of faith requires living a life of moral, spiritual, and religious perfection. Instead, living a faithful life means, as the slave singer urged, keep your hand on the plow, hold on. Hold on during periods of life when our confidence in ourselves and our faith is weakest. It is faith in our fate and a positive foresight about our future that provides us with the endurance required to live a life of meaning and worth, moving us to love rather than hate, to forgive rather than retaliate, to reach out to others rather than fixate on oneself. All of that is hard in today's world. It was no easier and a lot less safe when Jesus preached. His parables involved outreach to the poor, the outcasts, the prostitutes, the tax collectors. As a Jew, Jesus lived under the harsh occupation of Rome, administered by Jewish overseers whose positions depended on their ability to keep the peace. As Dr. Howard Thurman put it, if a Roman soldier pushed Jesus into a ditch, Jesus could not appeal to Caesar. In all his years, there was not a moment in which he was physically free. Indeed, during his ministry, there was never a day when his life was not in danger. Under Roman law, anyone who challenged the existing powers was identified, arrested, and summarily executed. Jesus is teaching that because God loved humanity, those who wished to please God had to love one another, as well as those beyond the family and the group, was a major departure from religion as generally known. The idea that God loves those who love him was entirely new in a pagan world where a host of gods and goddesses cared little for one another and even less for humans. When Jesus spoke of the kingdom of heaven as the ultimate power rather than the majesty of Rome, he threatened those who held both religious and political power. When great numbers of people began to follow him and heed his teachings, his execution was a virtual certainty. Indeed, the one fact about Jesus, about which there is no dispute, is that he was condemned by order of the Roman prefect Pontius Pilate, and in AD 30 was crucified, the form of execution the Romans used for political prisoners. Belief in a theistic God, that is a supernatural ruler of the universe, was universal among the Jews, and in different form among the early Christians. Philosophers tell us that belief in such a being relieved the anxiety that humans felt with their selfhood and the uncertain limits of life.
Oh,
Beautiful music eases the belief in a God that we cannot see. It is harder to sustain belief in a God we do not understand. That is the role of the church. Too often, though, while intending to nurture the essence of Jesus' teaching, the spirit in those teachings, it has suffocated them in rules and requirements that have sufficed for many, but driven from the church many more. The dilemma of the Christian church and of religion generally, then, is quite like the dilemma which we as lawyers must contend with as we try to both succeed and hold on to our integrity. The gravitational pulls of our free enterprise society urge acceptance of the social system as it is. It counsels us to compete and win by any available means. As needed, we can pretend we are ethical and humane. Our posturing will look like spirit and it will appear sufficient. The challenge for those who make living an ethical life their priority is to transform the symbolically sufficient into the substantively real. That, it seems to me, is what the old black farmer did back in 1965. He left his fields in Alabama to join the Voting Rights March from Selma to Montgomery. Given all the obstacles they faced, someone asked him, "Can we win?" The old farmer never broke his slow stride as he replied quietly, firmly, "We won when we started." Those of you in law school have started. Join the old farmer and understand and rejoice in the significance of that start. And though it appears inconsistent, we can strengthen our commitment to our professional and personal goals by merging our emerging spiritual understandings with the music written and sung with an assurance that is motivated by faith, more by faith than an expectation of a certain outcome. That was certainly the case for the hymn that became the anthem for the civil rights movement, "We Shall Overcome."
I would like to say how humbling it is for me and others to have the opportunity to read the words and thoughts of Derrick Bell and to continue to this student enrichment program. Those of you who knew Derrick knew that he always said, "Students first." I thank all who made this possible, and of course, Derrick's beloved students, those who knew him personally, and those who have come since. I also want to take one moment to say, isn't she something, that Amy Neuner, the minister of music at First Presbyterian Church? And before we sing the final hymn, Amy, will you please introduce those wonderful instrumentalists as well? A microphone. She's so busy conducting.
Ken Thompson on saxophone. Chris Neuner on bass guitar. Will Smith at the piano. And Matt Crawford on drums. And our sound guy back there, Jeremy, you can't see him.
Thank you. And of course, the wonderful readers tonight, thank you. Please stand up. Join us. Donald Cooley, Yvonne Elosiebo, and Professor Kendall Thomas. Now, I would like to dedicate this last song to someone I actually had the privilege of knowing, the great, late Pete Seeger, who died just a short time ago at the age of 94, still singing for justice until the very end. If you allow me, and I have some nerve after what you've just heard, I'm going to start, and then the choir and everyone else, please join in.